Today we continue on with the great saga of data mining. We're going to break into some potential future Pacific DLC content that's been unearthed by Tempor Yal. He's collated a bunch more information for us to all digest. We've got maps to talk about, weapons to talk about, and some other details to go over, so I hope you're ready for this one. But just before we get into all of that, today's video is sponsored by Elgato. If you're looking to capture and share your gaming experiences with your friends, Elgato has got you covered with their HD60S capture card. It allows you to save 1080p 60fps files straight to your PC or Mac, and if you're so inclined, you can live stream straight to Twitch, YouTube, or Mixer, any live streaming platform of your choice. For more details on any of Elgato's products, click the link in the description. Okay then, let's start off with what I think is the killer information from this data mine. We're going to talk about maps first of all. Previous to this data mine, we knew three maps from the Pacific Theater would be launching before the end of 2019, and DICE confirmed one of those would be Iwo Jima. We now have greater detail on what else is likely to be coming. A fourth map has been located in the files. That ups the total amount that we're likely to see come to the game, and the name Wake Island has been found. That's right, the classic Battlefield map that's been in countless previous games is looking very likely to return in Battlefield 5. And honestly, as much as that excites me, it really doesn't surprise me. It's the perfect moment for DICE to recreate some of their previous work in a current game, and Wake Island is hard to ignore when your World War II game moves from a European theatre into the Battle of the Pacific. Now, right at this moment, we don't have any images or artwork of Wake Island in Battlefield 5, but considering the last time we saw the map in a Battlefield game was back in 2011 with Battlefield 3, 8 years ago, I wouldn't be surprised if we see a big jump in graphical fidelity. So now we have Iwo Jima and Wake Island. The other two maps in the files are currently labelled with what appear to be working titles. They're called Jungle and Tropic Islands. Previous concept artwork that's been released by DICE for the Pacific Theatre does give us a greater sense of what these maps may end up looking like, and if they do look anything like these two images here, then I think we're in for a treat. Now, with three of these four maps scheduled to launch in 2019, it does very much look like DICE will be pushing the Pacific Theatre into 2020 a little bit with that fourth map, which I think is great news. It gives us greater hope that there are plans for this game beyond the Pacific Theatre for Battlefield 5. A lot of the community has been skeptical about whether support for this game would actually go on much further, considering all the problems this game has had and the backlash the game received for its rather tone-deaf approach to the World War II conflict, but it seems that some of those doubts can be put to rest, at least for now. Based on Oscar Gabrielsson's recent comments regarding DICE's support of their games, and he cited Battlefront 2 as an example of their work, my fears were somewhat calmed. But in light of this extra information that we now have, I've got even more confidence that the future of Battlefield 5 is going to extend into 2020 and maybe even a little bit further. The premise with the Tides of War Live service was to work our way through World War II over a certain period of time, going right from the beginning of the conflict all the way to the end. With the Pacific Theatre, we're somewhere in the middle, and if DICE wants to complete that journey of World War II, then they've still got a fair way to go. But all of this information is at least making me hopeful for the future of Battlefield 5. And whilst we're on the topic of maps, I will quickly touch on something that I've seen discussed in the comments of some of my videos. I do fully expect DICE to continue their release structure of pushing out one map at a time into Battlefield 5 with the Pacific Theatre. Just because the Pacific represents a big shift in setting, I don't think that necessarily means that DICE is going to change their tactics. I know some people have been saying in the community that Premium would have been better for Battlefield 5, and I want to talk about that in another video because I just completely disagree with that, but if you release one map every month until the end of 2019, and then possibly that fourth map into early 2020, that means each of the new maps can be played properly by all players before another one arrives. And this is, whether you want to admit it or not, one of the advantages of a live service system over a premium system. When maps are all released at once, they're consumed much more ineffectively than if they were released separately. And I always imagine this in my head when I'm talking about premium versus live service. Imagine sitting in a restaurant and the waiter brings you your starter, your main course, and your dessert all at once, and you had to eat it all in one setting. You'd likely struggle to eat all that food on your table, and you wouldn't be able to enjoy each part of the meal properly because you'd be wanting to eat another part of it. That's like premium in Battlefield games when all of the maps come at once. You get caught between four different maps, and you never properly experience those maps because you don't want to miss out on playing the other ones. So with a live service, you get one map at a time, one course at a time if you were in a restaurant, and then you can properly digest that before you move on to the next course. You can properly digest the map before DICE releases another one. At that point, you're ready to move on. Okay then, enough culinary-based comparisons, it's time to move on with the video. We're going to move on to weapons now. Tempo Yao has uncovered a few more since the last time we spoke about the Pacific content from that data mine, and we have five of them to discuss. So, first of all, the BAR-1918A2. This is a select-fire, fully automatic rifle that was cleared for development in 1938, and it features two different rates of fire, depending on which position the toggle was put in. It featured a skid-footed bipod that was fitted to the end of the barrel, and a flash suppressor was added to the end of the barrel as well. And towards the end of World War II, later models of this weapon featured a carrying handle on the barrel as well. I mean, how could this not be a weapon that DICE adds to Battlefield 5? It's an iconic World War II weapon. It's been a long time coming. We've had to wait for the American faction to become a choice in the game before seeing it, but the BAR will very likely be a part of the Pacific DLC. Next on the list, the Type 97 machine gun. This was the standard machine gun fitted to Japanese tanks and armored vehicles during World War II, and it will very likely be coming to Battlefield 5 as an infantry weapon as well. Of course, machine guns go into the support class. Then we have the Nambu Type 2A submachine gun. This was an experimental weapon produced by the Japanese before the start of World War II, and it was chambered for the 8mm Nambu cartridge. It was issued to naval units for use right the way through until the end of the war. Then there's the Type 94 sidearm, this again a Japanese weapon. It was known for being quite complex in its manufacture, but some soldiers liked that it was very compact and lightweight. And then the fifth weapon on the list, the last one, there's something strange about it. It's the M3 IR sniper rifle, infrared sniper rifle. This is an American creation, one of the first uses of night vision or infrared vision by the US in combat. And it fits an infrared light amplifying scope on top of an M1 carbine. About 150 of these were actually used by the US on Okinawa and were apparently quite effective, which is quite interesting. In Battlefield 5, the weapon DICE will likely be bringing to us will also feature a suppressor for reducing noise when firing, which adds into that role of perhaps a nighttime sniper. This could mean that we see a night battle of some sort in Battlefield 5, maybe? Maybe we'll see Okinawa as one of the other two maps. At this point, we don't really know all that much, but an infrared sniper will certainly have a cool factor surrounding it if it does make it into the game, but it does have me slightly worried at the same time. What kind of combat is this thing going to end up creating? We already have a major bipod proning issue in Battlefield 5, where players just blend into bushes and trees. A player holding on to an infrared scoped sniper is going to be like the ultimate stealth bush Wookiee of Battlefield 5. Next up, I've got some information on already known weapons that are set to be arriving with the Pacific DLC. So all those people in the comments are always like,
oh, where's the M1 Garand? Where is it? DICE, add it to the game.
It's right here, don't worry. It's been here the entire time. The M1 Garand is alive and well in the files. It's an already known weapon. It was at the end of the Chapter 4 trailer. It went with the beat of the Battlefield theme and then went cha-ching at the end. It was really cool. It's set to be a semi-automatic sniper rifle and therefore likely to be an assault class weapon. Don't worry, all the people who wanted the M1 Garand, it will eventually arrive into Battlefield 5. In one of our previous Pacific Focus videos, you might have heard me mention the Type 99 weapon. We weren't sure at that point if it was going to be a bolt-action rifle or a light machine gun, since both of those weapons have the Type 99 designation. It's now been found to be a bolt-action rifle. This is likely going to compete with the American bolt-action rifle that DICE adds to the game as well. Then we have the katana and the burned plank melee weapons. They've got new descriptions that have been written for them. The katana reads, "Many swords were produced in the years leading up to the war as Japanese officers were required to wear them. The quality varied dramatically due to the amount that was needed in the short period of time." And then the burnt plank, "In a pinch, anything can be picked up, and with one hand can become a weapon, even if it may be on fire." And then the Grease Gun SMG, the M1919 Browning MMG, and the Type 100 SMG, they're still present in the files too. And lastly for today, I thought we'd move on to everyone's favourite topic, cosmetic items, yay! The patch didn't reveal many new assets when it comes to soldier outfits really, but details have been lifted from the files that point towards the amount of different clothing options that we're going to get in the Pacific update. Both the American and Japanese factions, they're going to have 8 different base sets of clothing, which will either be common or uncommon in their rarities. And then above those, each of those 8 base sets is going to get a rare and an epic variant, which will share the same look, but it's going to add some extra flair on top. So this image here shows you what I mean by this. The base clothing is called Badger, a common rarity. That sets the theme. And then on top of that, you have the rare Nomad set and the epic Besieged set. Per faction, there will be 24 individual sets of clothing. That means you're going to have a lot of options to choose from. For the American faction, some of the sets currently in the game for the Allied soldiers, they will cross over into the American section, as there are some American-themed sets in the Allied section already, so some of the sets we may already have access to. And it is worth noting that likely many of these new clothing sets, both for the Americans and the Japanese, they will become Tides of War reward items, armory items, and some of them might be included within booster packs sold for the game for real money, just like current cosmetics are. And then very finally, promise this is the last thing, we have some weapon skins to look at. Here you can see a fossilized set on the Browning machine gun. I must say this one does look rather flamboyant, and it's actually very reminiscent of some of the weapon skins that we saw in Battlefield 1. I liked a lot of those, so it's nice to see that kind of style coming into Battlefield 5. Then there's the Jungle 2 camo on the Tommy gun. You can see it's got some leaves attached to the barrel there. This looks like an epic level cosmetic. There are some other ones in the game already that have foliage on the barrel that are epic level, so this will probably be the same. And then finally, the dragon set on the Browning. You can see dragon wings on the body of the weapon, and then there's a skull mounted around the barrel with some metal patterned stock going on. I really like this one. It's like an all blacked out version, but with a little bit of bling as well. I really like this one. And then, no, I'm just kidding. That wraps up everything. Goes without saying, of course, that this is unofficial information taken as work in progress from the game file. So until we see something official from DICE, all of this information I've just given you is subject to change, but it is exciting nonetheless. Let me know your thoughts on all of it down below in the comment section. I'd love to hear what you think on some of this stuff, and drop the video a like if you enjoyed it. But until next time, my name is Westy, and I'll catch you guys in the next video.